Okay, so I'm afraid no chocolates today. I didn't have time to go to Tesco. But we're going to build on the stuff that we covered last week. I'm going to cover, I'm going to try and recover some of that material as well, because it's actually quite important and it's a foundation for understanding a lot of what we do. But the main theme of today's session is hypothesis testing, which forms an important part of many aspects of research. You may hear, depending in which department you're doing your postgraduate studies, you may hear people say that they don't like hypothesis-driven research or hypothesis testing. And what they mean is they don't like this formalism of having to state hypotheses and formally test them using a certain language. Although it's becoming increasingly commonplace, especially in the medical and dental literature. Fab is asking why they don't like it. And the reason, I think, it tends to come from the basic sciences. The reason people say they don't like it is because in the basic sciences, you tend not to state things in quite the same formal language as you might do in more epidemiology surroundings. That doesn't mean the method and the methodology is actually different. Often it just means that things like hypotheses and hypothesis testing are implied rather than explicitly stated. But it's a good practice to learn the language and learn the structure and adhere to the structure, even if you don't strictly use the language that I'm going to outline in today's session. So firstly, we're just going to remind ourselves that research is all about answering questions. And then we have this thing called research methodology, which consists of posing a question, designing some experiment and some kind of analytical process that you're going to use to answer that question. And with those things in place, then we go through the process of collecting the data, applying our analytical method to explore the data, and then this really important bit about discussing what we've found and how this affects other people in the research field and the wider implications of the work that we've done. It discusses how far we have gone to actually answering our original research question, and normally results in many more questions as a result. And I will keep stressing that discussion is the most important thing that we do. But you can only build a sensible discussion on a well-designed experiment, collection of data, and a sensible and appropriate analysis. And then there is what we do here, this bit, this thing called statistics, which we'll just refer to as the numbers that we're going to use to summarize our research findings and convey the message from our research. And once we've done our research and we've crunched some numbers, then there's a nice formal structure that we can use for reporting that research, comprising of some kind of introduction where we introduce the research field and our specific research question, the materials and methods where we explain how we're going to answer that research question, and then an objective statement of the results that we have obtained and highlighting some of the key aspects of that. Well, we don't interpret. And then, like I say, discussion goes through things like, is this a critique of what we've found? And we can bring our own opinions and the opinions of others. And we explore the limitations of what we've done and how it contributes. So it's worth having these structures in mind as we go through this. And last week, I introduced these Star Wars spacemen, and I know that will make some people uncomfortable, it will make other people smile, it will make other people go and rush out and watch the movies and forget all about statistics. But regardless, we imagined that we had discovered a new planet and we collected a little bit of data and we visualised that data. I think we looked at things like weight and height of individuals on this planet. And we considered whether sampling people who were very close to our spaceship would necessarily be representative of that population. And then, I'm now wondering if I've actually got loaded the right presentation up. Anyway, we gathered some information. We did this visualization through histograms, considered frequency tables, so the number of times a particular measurement occurred, the frequency. And we considered categorical and scale data. I think we used the terms categorical and quantitative data. That was a test, by the way, to see if anyone was going to prompt me. And you all failed miserably. I'm just going to see if I can turn off the screensaver. If you'll bear with me. Just in case we go over 3 hours, I'll set the computer to never turn off. Where are we? Okay. So those are some of the things that we looked at last week. Now, one of the things I tried to introduce was this thing called the normal distribution, which I'm sure there are a whole varying degree of knowledge of what this is in this room and understanding of it. By the way, I apologise, it's so hot in here, and already I'm feeling sleepy and I'm standing talking, so if you nod off, please try and do it where I can't see you so it doesn't make me feel upset and that everyone's just going to sleep. There's nothing I can do about the heat that I know of anyway. So the normal distribution describes the natural way that a lot of data tends to be distributed. So if you take lots of measurements, very often in nature, the range of measurements will, if plotted in a histogram, will take this characteristic bell shape. So last week we did this plot in histograms. So we looked at the number of measurements that fall within particular ranges. And we allowed SPSS to do all this for us. Now, it's really important to think about this again. The normal distribution, it's just a distribution of numbers. It just tends to be common. And it's described mathematically by something called a Gaussian function. You don't need to really know that. But the reason I tell you is that function, that mathematical equation, is defined by only two parameters. And those two parameters are the mean and the standard deviation. So this is why you come across the term parametric testing. You may not have come across that, but we will begin to use it. And it's called parametric because there are two parameters that define normal data. Well, there are parameters, and they are the mean and the standard deviation. And the implication of this is that if I measure something and I can find its mean and its standard deviation, which are quantities that we can calculate, then that is sufficient to describe fully the distribution of the data. So I don't need to take, I think last week we had the example where we had something like 2,500 measurements. But you don't need to take 2,500 measurements of something if you can assume that it follows a normal distribution. Because as soon as you've got enough measurements to calculate a mean and a standard deviation, you have all of the information to tell you the full distribution of that data. So what do I mean by that? Well, this curve has this shape, and under this shape, if you took a bunch of measurements of height, height's a good one because we all can relate to height, and you added all the measurements of height up and divided by the number of measurements that we've taken, that would be the mean. And then you can look at all those measurements we've taken, say we've taken 10, and you can calculate how much variation there is. So not all those measurements are the same. We talked about measurement uncertainty, which means that all the measurements vary a bit. And we have, and we can quantify how much variation there is through this thing called the standard deviation. So whether you have parametric or non-parametric data, you can always calculate how much variation there is. And that one measure of variation in data is the standard deviation. And it's just a number that we calculate, and you can use software to do it. You don't have to know the equation. And that tells you, on average, how much do my measurements vary. It just so happens that under the normal distribution, the standard deviation actually means something more significant. And what it means is if you take the mean, which is of your data, so the sum of all of your measurements divided by the number of measurements, and then you subtract from that one standard deviation, so one times this number, and then you add to it also one standard deviation, often called sigma, Greek character sigma, or Greek letter sigma. And then you would have two numbers. You'd have a lower bound and an upper bound here. Under the normal distribution, you would find that 68% of your measurements fall in that range. So you take 100 measurements of the height of an individual, 68 of them will fall in this range, plus or minus one standard deviation from the mean. And you can begin to see how that curve is built up, because you go to plus or minus two standard deviations from the mean, and you have this slightly wider range here now. But as you see, if say one standard deviation is there, so you've got 68% in here, and then you have the remaining out here. So two standard deviations either side of the mean, we have 95% of our measurements. This is just if we're measuring something. Sorry, we have... It's at least someone was watching. I think two people were, actually. I saw two hands. You passed the test. Unfortunately, I have no idea how to fix this. Are we back? We're back. Okay. And there's a reason we need to understand this. And it's because these characteristics, these properties of normal distribution are then used for all parametric tests. All parametric tests rely on this fact, and this is just some kind of mathematical fact. And all you just need to do is accept that it's true. Okay, in three standard deviations, we get to 99.7% of our measurements. So this just tells us about how our measurements are distributed. It doesn't tell us anything else. It's a description of the measurements. So if I have a group of people, I'm not sure, I had to draw the people, and I measured all of their heights, then there'd be some variation in the measurements. So yeah, I'd have a range of measurements, and maybe they come under this normal curve. And that's all I'm saying. All that curve says is there's a range of heights in this group of people. Is there anything else? It tells you how much of a range there is, or how much of a variation there is. So the standard deviation tells me, for example, maybe people's height varies from 150 to 180 centimeters. Maybe. And so you measure that, and all it tells you, okay, there is a variation, and I can now quantify how big that variation is. Now, what I might want to know, so here I've got four people that I've sampled maybe from a population of 100. So I've just measured four people out of 100. Now what I want to know is how confident, if I take the mean of these four people's heights, so I take H1 plus H2 plus H3 plus H4, and I divide that by 4, which is the mean of that sample, how confident can I be that mean is the same as the mean of all of the 100 people? So I'm going to have a population of 100 people, and how can I be sure that if I take four of them and measure their mean height, that mean actually is representative of all of the 100? And what we have is this thing called the standard error of the mean. And the standard error of the mean is an expression of how certain we are that a sample mean represents a population mean. So the sample is the four people, and the population is the 100 people. And there's a little bit of a small equation, something to remember. The thing that you really need to know is that these things are called confidence intervals. So a confidence interval tells you the percentage certainty that you have that a sample mean represents a population mean. So I can now say I can calculate a value with which I am 95% certain represents, or a range that I can say with 95% confidence represents the population mean, the mean height, for example. So let's consider again, I've got 100 people, I'm not going to draw all 100 of them. I'll just draw a few. And let's say, okay, well, I'm going to take three of these and look at their mean. And maybe they have a mean represented by that character mu. And they have a mean height of, say, I don't know, 168 centimeters. Let's say I take another three And they won't have the same mean because they're different three people. And they might have a mean of 157 centimetres. Well, that doesn't mean the first measurement was wrong. That just is what the mean of that sample was. And likewise, the second measurement's not wrong. It's just the mean of what the second sample is. And we can continue to do this for multiple means, for multiple samples. And you'd get a different mean value in each of those samples. But what you can also do for each sample is it will have a standard deviation. Because there'll be some variation within the sample. So going back to the previous slide, whenever we take measurements, we can calculate a mean and a standard deviation. All we're doing in each sample is taking a mean and a standard deviation. And looking back at this slide, we can calculate this thing called the standard error of the mean by taking the standard deviation and dividing it by the square root of the number of measurements in the sample. So here, the SEOM would be equal to sigma over the square root of n. Again, the maths is not really that important. It's just to show you, in terms of, you don't need to necessarily remember equations, what you need to be aware of is that we can calculate this thing called the standard error of mean based on the standard deviation and the number of measurements in the sample. And because of that, we can then calculate something called a confidence interval. And the confidence interval is a range within which we expect the population mean to be based on our sample. So then we can calculate the confidence interval as the, let's say, the mean of one of the samples. So I'm just going to say sample one, plus or minus 2 times the standard error of the mean, which we calculated here. And so suddenly, rather than having to take multiple samples of the data set of this population, if we can assume a normal distribution, we can get rid of those multiple samples. We just take one sample, and then a little bit of fancy maths gives us this thing called a confidence interval. And the 2 here tells us that's 2 standard errors of the mean. And what we've actually done is we've said, okay, when I take multiple samples and calculate the mean, those means aren't all the same, there's some variation. Oh, hang on, when we do this with any kind of measurement, there is some kind of variation. If we can then assume that this forms a normal distribution, so the sample means themselves fall under a normal distribution, then they will have a standard deviation that makes some kind of quantitative statement. That standard deviation of many sample means is the standard error of the mean, and we've calculated it. So what you have here is a distribution of sample means and some estimate of how much it varies. And because you've got that, you can have the confidence interval. So this is now my mean of sample means. So it's a mean of means. It has a variation, which actually is now, it's the standard deviation of the sample means, which is called the standard error of the mean. And the nice thing is with that, I know that 95% of sample means, so I take 100 samples, 95% of them will have a mean that fits in that range there. These things here are my confidence intervals that I've calculated down here. So when you see standard error of the mean and confidence intervals, that's what it means. Clear as mud, right? Fortunately, you will be able to refer to this highly exciting slide at your leisure. I wanted to go through this again. We covered it last week. I've tried to cover it again. I would encourage you to try to get to grips with this concept if it's something that you struggle with. Yes, can I? Okay, I would encourage you to ignore that for the moment because I think you've mixed two things up, and hopefully it will become a bit clearer as we go on. The confidence interval itself is just a measure of essentially the variation in sample means. So it tells you nothing else. It just tells you how much sample means will vary. And so it stands to reason if you take larger sample sizes, there will be less variation between sample means. But at this stage, although this is used to calculate statistical significance, which is what the question was about, at this stage, it's purely a descriptor of how sample means vary. And the main point of this is that if you've got a large population, you could find out a lot about it by taking multiple samples. But the point is, you don't need to take multiple samples if everything follows normal distribution. And so by taking one sample, you can then calculate the variation, calculate your confidence in how representative your sample is of the whole population. And it's that basis, it's on this basis that pretty much all scientific research is done, whether it is a population-based study in terms of human populations or whether it is some kind of lab study. We rely on the fact that we can just take a few measurements and that will be representative of a whole, of all measurements. And we will go on later on to discuss how representative things are. But the confidence interval gives you, initially, it says, well, if I were to take multiple samples, I would expect this amount of variation. And so it gives you an idea of what the underlying variation is. And all research really is looking at variation. We're saying, well, things vary, but on average, what's the average behavior of something? And these are the numbers and the terminology that we need to become familiar with to summarize and explain real life variations. So today we're going to get into, as I said before, hypothesis testing, which does relate to the earlier question of things like significance. So last week I did mention p-values. I'm going to try and put those into some more context this week as we go on to discuss hypothesis testing. So firstly, we've already covered the fact that a research question is just a question that we are going to answer by some research. And a research question, and unless our research question is purely how many teeth are there in the world, or unless it is purely a number, research questions can very often be broken down into some form of comparison, whether that is comparing to some reference standard, which is often, most frequently, what is done, or comparing between two experimental treatments. Very often, we will have a comparison. And when we have a comparison to make, we can formally describe this by hypotheses. And most importantly, this thing called the null hypothesis. I think we may have briefly mentioned this last week. And the reason the null hypothesis is important is it is simply the statement that there is no difference between two things that we're comparing. So whatever those two things we're comparing are, the null hypothesis is that there is no difference. So null equals nothing equals no difference. And so if you remember that null equals nothing, then you're on the way to remembering that the null hypothesis is a hypothesis that there is no difference. And simply it is a statement that there is no difference. You may also come across the term alternative hypothesis. It's not always necessary to state an alternative hypothesis. Often, if we find that there is a difference between two things, then we will say that we have to reject the null hypothesis. Null hypothesis is not true, and therefore it's rejected. And so we may favour some alternative to that. Now, that alternative may not be fully described by our research that we've done. We may not be able to explain really fully that difference. But all we can say is that there is a difference. But there's some certain things that we can look at. We can look at directional difference. So we could say the height of this group of people is greater than the height of that group of people. And therefore, there is a difference. Null hypothesis rejected. And we have to form some alternative explanation for this result. And the directionality can mean that we need less samples in our experimental work. And so sometimes when it's difficult to measure or unethical to measure more individuals than you need, for example. Or maybe you need to include people in a study for a new drug. And perhaps your ethics committee would say, well, it would be they really want you to justify your numbers. And if you're only looking for a difference that says one group is bigger than the other group, then you can halve the number of people that need to participate in the study. So it's an important consideration where you really do need to be careful about only exposing the necessary number of people, for example, to some procedure. But generally speaking, we will probably concentrate more on this question of, is there a difference? And again, the directional difference is something just to maybe look up quickly in a book. And so again, we talked about p-values last week, and I made this statement that it's the probability that an observed result could be observed by chance. But actually, in terms of hypotheses, we have this formal statement that it is the likelihood or the percentage chance or the probability of obtaining an observed result if the null hypothesis is correct. Now, this can take a bit of mind bending. Some people will get this straight away and they go, yeah, that makes perfect sense. Others will go, hang on, have we got double negatives? What's going on here? This language is not straightforward. And you tend to find this quite a lot. So first look at the null hypothesis. The null hypothesis is that hypothesis that there is no difference. Null, no difference. If the null hypothesis is correct, well, that just means there is no difference. It's correct. So now let's say we've measured two things. Well, what's the chance that we would... And we measure two things and we see a difference between them. What's the chance that we would see that difference even if in reality there is no difference. And that's the question we're asking when we do a comparison test or a hypothesis test. We're asking, okay, I've seen a difference, but what's the chance that that just happened because there's variation in the data? Yeah, sometimes we'll see a difference when really there isn't one. And we want to minimize that. And the way we go, again, formally, about deciding when we have seen a true difference or a or the difference is just one that could occur by chance and therefore it's not a real difference, is using this thing called significance. Now, it's something we shouldn't get too hung up on, because statistical significance doesn't mean experimental significance, worldwide significance, amazing importance. It's just a threshold number. I've had a fair number of students doing research projects with me, and we always get to the end of the projects, and people always want to have significant results. Now, results can be scientifically significant without being statistically significant. But when we're doing research and we use this word significance, we are generally speaking about statistical significance, and this has a particular meaning. And it's this threshold. It's this threshold of probability at which we will reject the null hypothesis. So rejecting the null hypothesis is saying that there really is a difference. And the p-value is the probability that there really is, the probability that we would see a difference when there isn't one. So a small p-value means there's less chance of seeing a difference if there isn't one. So significance is the probability at or below which I'm prompted to reconsider the null hypothesis as explanatory for my data, or probability at which I will reject the null hypothesis. The probability at or below which I will say there really is a difference between the two things I'm comparing. And then frequently I get asked, well, how do I calculate this threshold, this significance value? And the answer is you don't calculate it, you choose it. So this is a matter of scientific opinion as to at what point you're going to decide that you really can see a difference between two things that you're comparing. Remember, this is all probability, it's all chance. So it doesn't mean there really is a difference. It just means that you can think of it in terms of at what point will I think it's worthwhile doing further study in this direction. So let's say I'm comparing two drugs. You say, at what p-value will I decide that actually I'm going to pursue drug A over drug B? And that's really the question you're asking yourself. But there are some conventions to help us. So in the absence of all other information, there is a 95% level, threshold level. So when the p-value, the statistical significance of our results, goes below 5%, we're saying, well, actually, there's a 5% or less chance that I would have seen the difference that I've seen if there really wasn't a difference. So if I had two drugs that actually have exactly the same effect on recovery time, I wouldn't have seen, or there's a 5% chance or less that I would have seen a difference in recovery time that I have observed. But it's up to you to decide an acceptable level, and sometimes actually that level might be much higher. So I was doing some work over the summer on enamel demineralization and trying to detect it using some light scattering methods. And actually, the results, taking everything into account, and the context, the variability in the results, the number of samples that we had, actually, to be convinced that we were actually looking at whether to use an acidic or a neutral, actually this was remineralization, remineralization of enamel. And we were interested in whether we wanted to pursue an acidic or a neutral remineralization solution. There's various literature supporting either kind. Now, there's a huge variation in our data. And actually, we don't get p-values down at this 5%. We were sort of up at 20%. So we accept the differences that we saw could just be down to randomness. And if we did it enough times, maybe we'd actually find there was no difference. But based on a number of other factors, it seems worthwhile to us to pursue the neutral remineralization solution. Now, so we had to use our expertise and lots of other information to inform us. We don't just focus on what the p-value is. But when we're not given any other information, this is our guide. But it's important to know what it means. Related to this, of course, is something else, something that we can call clinical or practical significance. So let's say I'm testing out two drugs, and recovery times for patients is my measure of how effective they are. And actually, when I do this, I do find a statistically significant difference. So I find that there is a difference between the two drugs. But the difference is of the order, say, over a 1 week recovery period, is a difference of an hour. And so, well, drug A is actually, you, on average, will recover 1 hour quicker compared to drug B. Well, either clinically or from a patient's perspective, is this really that important? Probably not. Or maybe I'm measuring the height of individuals, and we find that in two groups of individuals, there is a 1 millimeter difference in height. Does that matter? Probably not. It might be statistically significant. We might be able to say that we're really confident that that difference exists. But for practical purposes, who cares? It's just not important. And so these are really important things to consider. And so when we're designing an experiment or we're designing some research, we can specify at the outset the what's called the effect size that would actually be important for our work. So that is the size of the difference that really would be important. So even if we find a statistically significant difference, if it's not bigger than the effect size that makes it important, then you know what? We can then write about that in our discussion and write about the merits of pursuing, say, drug A or drug B. And therefore, it is determined by the purpose of the measurement. And then we move on to our experiments. And so for those of you who watched the Star Wars movies over the last week, you now get to indulge your newfound knowledge. So we're going to undertake a simple experiment, again using SPSS as our fancy calculator. And can I encourage you as well, if with the things that I've been going through, it may be that however unlikely it seems, it may be that you have no idea what I'm talking about. Now, if you then come and speak to me and I say the same gobbledygook to you and you leave, you nod, you smile at me and walk away none the wiser, you can come back for another dose. And I'll probably do the same. I'll try to, in my mind, I'll be describing it in the clearest possible fashion, using new and innovative ways to communicate with dentists. But that may not work. And if it doesn't work, that is why I work with SABA, because we have two different ways of thinking about the same subject, and SABA can give you a completely different way of thinking that may well resonate with the way that you think. Thanks, Saba. So there is hope anyway. Please, and please do speak to Saba if you would find that helpful. She, I know certainly in the past people have found that she will explain things completely differently in a way that you may understand. And it, you know what, we all think differently, and that's okay. Except, of course, when it comes to the subject of Star Wars, where we're all, it's all necessary that we think in a very particular way. Now, so we're going to undertake an experiment using SPSS. And I've tried to format this in a kind of generally following the guidelines for scientific reporting and scientific methodology, research methodology. So you'll see that this slide is entitled Introduction. And so I'm writing an introduction. I'm introducing you to this field of science called Star Wars height comparison. For me, I have omitted the titles of this paper. But. So I'm going to explain some background. Well, I'm not actually going to. You've watched the movies now, so you're familiar with the background of Star Wars. But what we have is we have two groups of people. And group one are called clone troopers, and group two are called storm troopers. And they look, as is shown in figure 1A and figure 1B. And we can write some waffle about who these people are. However, if this causes you great anxiety, or you are adamant that you will not watch Star Wars and have no interest in the subject, and it's not helpful to the teaching of statistics, then we have a more dentally relevant example. There are two groups of people called orthodontic dentists and restorative dentists. And on average, they look like this. We have two groups of people. I'm going to continue with Star Wars, but if you like, please feel free to substitute for clone trooper orthodontic dentists and for storm trooper restorative dentists, or any other grouping that you see fit. Anyway, both groups are genetic clones. This is probably true of both dentists and storm troopers. So they should be identical in the case of a dental example. Maybe they're not clones, but they're people. They should have generally the same characteristics, we might suppose. But there is some anecdotal evidence now coming out that the two groups exhibit unexpected differences. In my favourite example, stormtroopers are in some way different to clone troopers. Shock horror, this should not be the case. We have been commissioned to investigate this phenomena. Is it true? Are the anecdotes real or true? Or is it just stuff made up by the papers to sway public opinion? Indeed, are orthodontists different to restorative dentists? I imagine some of you will have opinions on that subject itself. Are they just opinions or are they based in evidence? Well, that is what we wish to find out. So we have a research question. And again, as you will be well aware, the best metric, or a good metric of the equivalence of two groups of people, is their height. And so therefore, we aim to answer the question, is the average height in two groups, in these two groups, different? Because if it is, this has important consequences for society. And we get to write about that in our introduction. So, then we start to set about what the research is that we're going to do. Would someone please like to offer a null hypothesis for this research? Everyone looks down immediately. I don't even have chocolates to offer. Sad state of affairs. I will pick on someone. Just depends how energetic I'm feeling. Let's see, hand. Yeah, we've got a hand. That sounds like a brilliant null hypothesis to me. And I'm glad, just in your answer, that you bought into the whole Star Wars thing. So that's another really good point. Just to make you aware, we won't talk about Star Wars in an exam situation. So don't revise the various aspects and nuances. Okay, so null hypothesis. Is no difference between clone troopers and no difference in height, I should say. Of course, I left that space on purpose. Clone troopers and storm troopers. Excellent. So we've now made our first step towards exciting scientific discovery. There you go. That's just in case you couldn't read my handwriting. I have added written it down there for you. Okay, so we've set this null hypothesis up. How are we going to test it? Would anyone like to offer some opinions how we could actually, what we're going to do? What might our method be to discovering if indeed there is no difference between the two? For those of you checking Facebook, you have absolutely no idea what I'm speaking about. For those of you not checking Facebook, you probably also don't have any idea what I'm speaking about. Even so, we have two groups. We want to determine if there is a height difference between them. How would you go about determining that? And please don't tell me. Yes, we've got a new person over here. Well, not new, but a hand I haven't seen before. Okay. Sounds like a good suggestion. Randomized testing of the general population. Would anyone like to expand on that? No one wants to expand on that. There we go. Okay. Choose about 10 people from each group and measure their height. How are we going to measure their height? Okay, so we've got a BU public health. Oh, you're not someone who says dental public health love questionnaires. Okay, so we could rely upon self-reporting of height. Anyone else want to offer an alternative method? Have I got another hand? Come on. You must have measured your height. how to measure, how are we going to measure the height of the, so we've got, someone said some randomized sampling, someone else has offered that we could use 10 individuals from each of the groups, so we could randomly select them. Then we've had someone else say, and we could ask them to self-report their height through, you know, we maybe mail out a questionnaire and they report their height. And I've then asked, what other ways could we determine their height? So we have checking medical records, so perhaps they've had a, especially if they're in the military, maybe having regular medical checks and maybe their height is taken as part of that. Okay, so let's write these things down. And have random sampling. We're going to set maybe n equals 10 each group. Then the measurement method, maybe self-reporting, or perhaps register, or maybe doctor's records. Well, I can't spell. Well, something like that. So there we go. We've now outlined a materials and methods, or the start of this, how we're going to uncover this. And this is what we do. I mean, this is nothing really more complex than this. This was my one, which I'm quite pleased. So I had the randomly selected by computer program. So that's the method by which I've done the random selection. And maybe I assigned to each of their numbers. For the dentists, maybe I selected them by GDC registration number. And I've got a computer program to randomly select which ones I was going to sample. Here I said height measured by a general practitioner. And I said that they're going to use a tape measure. There are all sorts of ways that you can measure height. But that seemed like a reasonable one to me, so that's what I did. And someone, when they review this exciting piece of research, might disagree with that, and they might say, why didn't you use a fancy laser height measuring piece of kit? Well, they might ask for more details as to exactly how the tape measure was used and the protocol involved there. But this is what I've written. And then we write about how we're going to analyze this. How are we actually going to, so we measure all these people, what do we do with the numbers? And I'm saying we're going to use an independent samples t-test. And it was used to test the null hypothesis that there is no difference between the height of orthodontists and restorative dentists, or Republic and Stormtroopers. And then I stated that my threshold significance level for rejecting the null hypothesis, as in I will only say that I believe there really is a difference in height between these two groups, if I find a p-value less than 0.05. And I should point out that I'm only saying this within my experimental results. I'm not even saying that this represents, or how representative this is of all stormtroopers and clone troopers at this point. So we've written down the materials and methods, and now we're on to the results section. So we collect the data in the way that we've specified in our materials and methods. We apply statistical analysis, or some kind of quantitative analysis, in the way that we've specified in our materials and methods. And the results now is all about stating our findings. And so we think, well, what did we do last week? The first thing that we did was visualize the data. So that's what we're going to do now. We're going to go through some data and try and do this experiment. So I've collected the data. I have randomly sampled some stormtroopers and collected their height information. And we're going to do some analysis on that using SPSS. So while I'm trying to find the data, please fire up SPSS. You'll probably get into the habit of firing this up at the beginning of each session. I should have mentioned it earlier. I think it takes a minute or so to load. And while you're waiting for it to load, if you go to the course QM Plus site, remember, if you just get to QM Plus, if you don't immediately see the module, you can type in DIN7002 into the search bar. That's DIN7002. And the module Statistics, Ethics, and Research will pop up. And then you'll get to this page. And I think even with guest log on, you can get to the data. I'm going to test that now because I've got guest log on. And then what we're going to do, we're going to download, under the statistics data section, we're going to go to lecture 3. And for today, we're going to download characteristics of clone and stormtroopers. Now, this is actually the characteristics of all clone and stormtroopers, and we're going to sample this data. If you've got left behind or you're not quite sure where we are, try and find someone around you who looks like they know what they're doing and get them to help. And if no one knows what they're doing, please let me know. So what I'm going to do is click on that. And open the file. Okay. So do people, has this loaded up? Have a show of hands if it's been successful. Okay, generally speaking, it's worked. Now, again, I'm going to stick with Republic and clone and stormtroopers. But if you have got this screen up on SPSS, if you go to variable view, you'll see a screen that looks like this. And here at the bottom, there's something called type. So I've called this variable type. And under label, under values, and you get this box here, and you can click to the right, the box with dots. And I have defined that group 0, is Republic Clone Trooper, and group 1 is Imperial Stormtrooper. Once again, if you wish to protest about the use of Star Wars, you may, and you can put in two groups of your choice. You can put in orthodontic dentist and restorative dentist, for example, and then magically make this study a densely relevant one. You don't have to. I'm going to leave mine like that, but you can edit these, changing the text, press change. You're welcome to play with doing that. In fact, I'm going to just slightly change it. I'm going to take out the word Republic. There we go. Now it's just clone trooper, I press change, and stormtrooper. Press change. And now press OK. And you can also change the label. So this label will turn up on any plots or in any tables that output from SPSS. wanted to, you could change this to dentist type. Or anything you like. But that label is there to describe, for the benefit of you and other people that you'd present the data to, it's there to describe the output. So when you look at it, you know what it's actually showing you. You see, I've been quite busy. I've collected quite a lot of data here. Height, weight, age, and job satisfaction. I did a survey. We don't need that for the moment. So back in the data view, the first thing there, what did we do a lot of last week? Actually, before we do that, sorry, I forgot. We need to sample the data, don't we? This is everyone. And we were going to randomly sample our data. So the exercise in doing this is to use a function in SPSS that allows us to do it. So often you won't have all of the data in your file, so you probably won't need to do this, but we can for the purpose of demonstration. So let's go to the data menu. And at the bottom, there's an option, select cases. And we can use it in all sorts of ways, but one of the things that we can do is use it to randomly select a subset of the data. So click on that. And you'll see in the middle there, random sample of cases. So it's going to select a random sample of cases. When I press on sample, I get an option. Again, for the purpose of today, we're just going to sample approximately a percentage of the cases that we have, the cases of all of the individuals that we have in this worksheet. So each line in the data view is a case. Would anyone like to offer a percentage that they wish to explore? Sabbath is 15%. Anyone wants to try a different number? Maybe a lower number I've already tested it with. Does anyone have... Do I hear 10? The engineer's favourite value, 10%. Excellent. That sounds like a good starting point. So I'm going to put into there 10% of all cases. You don't have to. You can pick any number you like. Put a number in there. No, it's just going to take 10% of all cases. Yeah. So it's just going to say, well, you'll see what it's done in a moment. So once you've done that, press continue. And then press OK. SPSS goes away, does something, spits out something that looks rather technical. And you may need to use the window option to get from output back to the original worksheet or data set. So what you might see, is here, when you've done that, SPSS has put a line through these cases. So these are the cases that it has not selected, and it's only left open some of the cases, and these are the cases that have been selected, randomly chosen. Incidentally, I wonder if we will have different cases selected. But the hope is that we do, but I did try an experiment last year, and we ended up all having the same ones, which is quite disappointing. So we all have different cases. Great. So we'll all get slightly different output. And this is an important thing to be aware of. Because when we do someone else repeats our experiment, they won't get exactly the same result. And in fact, they could get a contrary result to us. Because when I was talking earlier about the confidence intervals and having variations in the sample means, That is what we should expect when we repeat this experiment across the room, that there will be variations. And sometimes some people might find differences and some people might not. Anyway, so we've selected our samples, and then we need to do something else. So do you remember what was the first thing that I said we're going to do with our data once we've collected it? Pardon? Okay, some descriptive statistics. That sounds like a good idea. Anything else that we might do? Histogram, I heard histogram as well. So these are two of my favorite things. The select cases? Yeah, sure. So we go to... You go to the data menu. That looks like this. And at the bottom, one from the bottom, you'll see select cases. And if you click on select cases, you'll get a window that allows you to randomly select. So I've clicked on select cases under the data menu. And here you have a box that says select. And the third option is random sample of cases. And you press sample, and we've put approximately 10% of all cases. And now we're going to let the computer randomly choose who is lucky enough to participate in this study. So when you press continue, so I put 10 in there. You can choose any number you like, but I've put 10%. I'm going to press continue, and then just press OK on the select cases box. And then you may need to go to the window menu. And back to the data set. And then you'll see these lines through the down on this side. Let's say these cases aren't selected, but say for me, case number 9 has been selected to participate in the study. And we can see that that one is a clone trooper. So we've had two suggestions of the first step in our analysis, and those were we're going to visualize using histogram and we're going to get some descriptive statistics. We're going to go through the histogram visualization first. And again, we're just going to use these menu options. So if you go to the graphs menu, feel free to jump ahead if you know where I'm about to go. We're going to Chart Builder, which is the first option. So it was Graph from the menu bar at the top, then Chart Builder. And then we get this Chart Builder box come up. And the thing we're looking for is histograms. So you've got gallery here. For me, that tab was already selected. And there's a histogram option here. And we can just let the software design us a histogram. Now, we have a couple of options on how to display this data. But because we've got two groups, maybe it'd be useful to have histograms that allow us to compare those two groups. Now, you can see that there's either that one, or that one allows us to compare multiple sets of data. I'm going to use this one here, so we can get a comparison of these two distributions. Remember, that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to compare the heights of two groups. So we really want to visualize those two groups side by side and see if they even look similar. So you can pick your chosen histogram and drop it in this window here. And it will look something like that. So you just press on the mouse button and drag the histogram in. Then we're interested in comparing height. So we're going to grab the height and drag and drop that on the this thing here that says distribution variable. So we're looking at the distribution of height. Then we have something called the split variable at the top. Anyone want to offer an opinion as to what we might want to put there? What are the two things that we're comparing? Okay, so it's the type, the stormtrooper or clone trooper, which is there. Here it says Republic or Imperial on mine because I didn't update the label. Yeah, that's the clone troopers or stormtroopers. It's the type of dentist is our split variable. That just means what are the two things we're comparing. So if you do that, you should have something that looks like this, and you can just press OK. And you should have something that looks like that. Now, if we've all got slightly different sampling, you may have a slightly different plot. Well, that's fine, because we've all done different experiments, looked at different clone and stormtroopers. And so we expect very slight differences in those distributions. And that is entirely acceptable. Would anyone at this stage like to make any statements about what they see on this plot? Any statements of either similarity or difference? Or you could refer to your own one. You don't have to refer to mine. Might be best because everyone can see this one. Do we have any takers? Well, I'm going to offer one one description, maybe, that in this data set, the majority of the clone troopers have a height, in this sample, have a height between, say, 182 to 184 centimeters. If you find the plot slightly confusing, turn your head on to 90 degrees to the side, either way, and it will look like a histogram. These are two histograms just plotted this way around, a sort of 90-degree rotation. What we can do to try and make it a bit clearer, if you go back to the graphs menu and back to the chart builder, it should all be set as it was to produce this. But what you also have is this element properties box to the right-hand side. If you don't, just press the element properties button there. So you've got this element properties button here to bring it up. And there's a checkbox for display the normal curve, which is here. And now you know what a normal curve is meant to look like. So if you apply that, you have to press the apply button at the bottom, and then press OK, we have one normal curve plotted here, And another normal curve plotted here. So they're just rotated from how we looked at them previously. But we still have frequency along this axis. So frequency, remember, is just the number of occurrences. So we have here four individuals in this height range, this 182 to 183 centimeters tall. And then this, when we look at the clone troopers, we can say that we've got two individuals who are in this bin, which is about 182 centimeters. So we're just comparing the distributions. Maybe that's not helpful to you. I find it, I'm a very visual person, so I find this very helpful to be able to look at data. And I'd encourage you to become familiar with looking at distributions because it's very helpful to be able to do this. Now, what's interesting, now that I've put the normal curves on there, is that I can see that the peak of the normal curve, the highest point, is actually quite similar. How similar? Who knows, but it's quite similar. Is this data normally distributed? Any opinions? Any thoughts? I have some shaking of the head. It doesn't look that normal, does it? I don't know, does your data look normal? Some of them may look perfectly normal, and that will just be chance. But regardless, in my limited knowledge, I only know how to use a t-test and parametric test, so I'm going to press ahead with using a statistical test that relies on normal distribution, even though my data might not look perfectly normal. I'll leave that to an exercise for us. I'll do it fairly quickly. So if you want these, the histograms we had last week, graphs, chart builder again, and simply, let's get rid of that. This time what we want to do is drag this histogram, the first one, and drop it up here, and bring the height and drop that on the x-axis. I'm going to check the normal curve again. No, actually, this is it. The problem with doing it this way, there is a slight limitation to this. You've reminded me why I chose to do what I just did, is that now this has combined both of our groups. So we haven't got any discrimination between our groups. There are ways using that select cases option that you're welcome to play with to filter out which cases you want to plot. There's all sorts of powerful ways of plotting this data, but if you want to use the straightforward built-in functionality, sometimes you just have to conform to the way SPSS wants to do things. So, I was trying to delete it. Doesn't matter. So we've done that. Let's plot some let's get our descriptive statistics as well. So the way we get to descriptive statistics is analyze, descriptive statistics, and let's just get the descriptives. So that was analyze, descriptive statistics, descriptives. We're only going to look at height at the moment. But again, this has grouped together all of our, both of our categories. So both stormtrooper and clone trooper. So that may be may limit our analysis, or limit what we can say with those. But fortunately, when we go to do the comparison test, the t-test, actually we get some statistics for free with that. So what do we want to do? Well, we want to compare the means. So the t-test compares the means of two groups. So we're going to compare the mean height of these two groups. So we go to analyze, compare means, and then we have this menu, and we have a few different tests that we can select from. Now, the stormtroopers and the clone troopers are completely independent groups. We haven't taken one group, made a change to them, measuring them before and after. We're just measuring two completely independent groups. So this is an independent samples t-test. The other one that you will come across is a paired t-test. You use a paired one when you do a before and after check. So let's say you are going to apply some treatment, take a group of people, and you want to compare them before and after the treatment. That would be paired because you're comparing the same group before and after. But in this case, it's independent samples because we have two completely independent groups. Or we're assuming that they're completely independent when we run this test. And you get the box up. We're going to put the height using the arrow into the test variables section. And here we have a grouping variable. And the grouping variable is exactly what it says, it's our groupings. So stormtrooper or clone trooper. Ortho or restorative. So we're gonna put into there the type, and then you'll see it has question marks. So we have to define those groups. Unfortunately, this is pretty straightforward. You say group one was coded as zero. So when we input the data, when we looked at those values under variable mode, we noticed that group zero was clone trooper and group one was stormtrooper. And all this wants to know is which two groups we're going to compare. We're going to compare the group that's coded as zero with the group that's coded as one. And we don't have any other groups, so that makes it pretty straightforward. So then we can press continue and press OK. And like I said, we then get the group statistics come out. So in this case, because we've randomly selected, we have ended up, or I have ended up, with 9 clone troopers being selected and 14 stormtroopers. So I don't have equal sized groups. Again, that is just a consequence of the protocol that I chose to follow. It's easiest to do it again. Someone was asking about editing the tables. If you want to redo things, often it's just easier to rerun. You can edit tables, but I find it more hassle than it's worth, so I would tend to just rerun the analysis. But what we get to see here is the means of our two groups. So for me, my means are around 183 centimetres. I have a standard deviation. So on average, the variation that I'm seeing in my data is of the order of about a centimetre. So I'm having the, in both groups, they seem to vary by about a centimetre in height. And then we have this thing called the standard error of the mean, which we discussed earlier. which allows us to construct confidence intervals. Now, I'm not going to do that just this second. But the thing to note is that the t-test actually uses that information. So it uses knowledge of how much the samples, the sample means would vary in two groups to work out the probability that there really is a difference, or the probability that we would see the difference that we've seen, even if there was actually no difference, or even if these two groups are the same. So the difference that we've seen between the two groups is expressed in this table here, the column, the mean difference. And these are the kinds of things that you need to be familiar with being able to read. So if you're shown a table like this and asked to extract bits of information from it, or asked to make some assessment, you need to be able to look at one of these tables and know what it's telling you. So there are certain things that we're just going to ignore, that actually for anything that we're going to do is just not going to be important. So the first thing to know is that we're not even going to look there. The other thing, for the purposes of this course, you'll see that there's two rows here. So we've got independent sample t-test. We're never going to assume equal variance, so we're going to ignore the top row there. We're also never going to look at the t-statistic or the degrees of freedom. These are things that you might want to look at in the future. There are things that can be useful, but there's no point in getting bogged down in that now. So let's just cross out the numbers that we're not going to look at. What we are interested in, though, is the mean difference. So mean difference, that is the difference in the means of the two groups that we've just measured. And it's about 0.3 centimeters. So 3 millimeters. We probably should have said what would we consider our effect size for this study. Is a 3 millimeter difference really important? But that's the difference between the two groups, the two samples. But we have this value here that's our p-value. So whenever you see an output that says sig, it's the p-value. The two-tailed thing is whether we're looking at a directional difference. So if I was saying, is one group smaller than the other or one group bigger than the other? If I was being directional, that's one-tailed. For the purposes, again, of this course, we will generally only ever talk about two-tailed, where we're saying it could be either bigger or larger. Is there a difference, regardless? So can anyone tell me what this p-value means here? Its value is 0.523. Can you make a concise statement about what that is saying? Okay, so can you maybe take a step back and make a simpler statement? Okay, so the difference that we're saying is the difference that we're seeing is probably due to chance. What is the chance that there is no difference? What is the probability that the observed difference is down to chance? It is, so about... Do we all have, what kind of values do you have? I have here 52%. I wonder what's the highest value we've got here? What, 56? Any advances on 56? 58? Any advances on... And what's the lowest we've got? Have we got anyone below 50%? Okay, they're all fairly consistent. So good. But actually, what that's telling us two things. One, there's not much variation in that p-value. So we can be reasonably confident in it. I'm just going to make that qualitative statement that we can be reasonably confident in it. But that's quite interesting, and it's useful to know, because that then implies that our sample size is sufficient to represent the whole population of stormtroopers, even though we've only taken 10%. When you take a random 10%, we all roughly get the same answer. So we've repeated the experiment across the room, and we all agree. So that's quite important. And we later on in another session, we'll actually talk about how we quantify that. But it's useful to be aware that we've all done the same experiment and got roughly the same result. Okay, so the question is, we've got a p-value of p equals 0.56, say. And then I said that's 56% chance. So I'm just multiplying. So a p-value is between 0 and 1. And if you want that in percentage, you multiply it by 100. So I just tend to swap between probability, which is 0 and 1, and percent chance, which is just multiplying the value by 100. It's a bit of a habit. But what we're saying, so we say the definition of the p-value is the probability or the chance, the percent chance, that we would see the observed difference between two groups, even if there isn't a difference. And so we're saying, well, there's a 50, in my results here, there's a 52% chance that I would see this difference, even if there isn't a difference. Well, my threshold was 5%, and way above that. So I'm going to accept the null hypothesis. There doesn't appear to be a difference between the two groups. And it sounds like everyone else would agree based on what we've done. So I think I've probably discussed these things, these slides. You can use those for thinking about this in the future. So we've been through these. So here, actually, this is when I ran this earlier today. And there we go, I got 57%, or p equals 0.57. So in reporting this in a results section, I would write the probability that there is no difference in the mean height of both groups is estimated to be p equals 0.575, if I wanted. I probably wouldn't express a p-value to any less than any greater precision than two decimal places. And I would probably, so that's 0.575, I would probably just say 0.58. If I was reporting that. And we remind ourselves that and based on that result, the null hypothesis is accepted. Meaning we find no difference in this experiment. And so we've generated this result section, which just states what we've seen. And now it's important to discuss these findings. What does it mean? Is it important? Are there problems with what I've done that could perhaps draw these results into question? So can we offer any critique of the experimental method? Anyone have anything? Or is it actually perfect? Okay, so what was just said is that we looked at the data and we said it didn't look normal, but we still pressed on and used a test that assumed normality of the data. So I'm going to put that down as a critique of the analysis that used a parametric test. Even though we doubt normality. Now, if I was discussing this, I might say, if I knew that we'd all done the same experiment and got the same value, I might say, this may draw into question the exact p-value. So that p-value might be wrong. We maybe should get a slightly higher or slightly lower value. However, when I actually look at the data, the actual distributions don't look so vastly different to lead me to conclude that there really should be a difference. It just means that the parametric test might not accurately describe the differences that are there. But when I look at the data, I still think it looks the two distributions look the same. So my p-value might not be exactly right, and the mean difference might not be exactly descriptive of the differences that are there. But for reasons of looking at the data, when I examine the plot, for example, I do see that they look similar, and I've seen results from other groups, so and it makes me feel confident there is no difference. Also, that p-value was very high. So it's not like this was borderline. It's not like this was p equals 0.06, and we're reluctantly accepting the null hypothesis. It's actually it's such a large p-value, even if it's slightly wrong, even if it should be p equals 0.2, we would still have accepted the null hypothesis. These are discussion points, because someone will criticize, as you just have, this use of the parametric test. And we can say, well, yeah, there are deficiencies there, but actually, we're still confident in the overall finding, even if quantitatively there may be some ambiguity in those numbers. Does anyone have anything to offer on the method itself? Okay, so someone said the sample size could be too small. Now, there are formal ways to look at that, which we may discuss another time. What I would say, though, so actually, on the basis of the one experiment, you're absolutely right. So let's just put this in. Cool. Size could be too small. However, we've gathered data from several research groups, as in everyone here who's done this, and we all got roughly the same p-value. We all got roughly the same result, which actually suggests, without going to further analysis, actually suggests that the sample size is adequate. So then we're taking into account. So when it's quite often that it will happen that you'll do some research and you aren't really able to do formal sample size calculations for it, or you have to make a whole load of estimates to get your sample size. And the only thing you can really do is look at other literature, look at what other people have done, to see if your sample sizes make sense and your results make sense. And if you're getting results like that p-value that's in broad agreement with a lot of other people, then you might not be able to make a quantitative statement or a very forceful statement that your sample size is definitely okay. But what you could do is argue the reason that you think your sample size is adequate. And so in this case, I would argue the sample size is actually okay because we all got, how many of us there are, say 40 people were in broad agreement within a certain range, say between P equals 50%, 60%. I'm going to just offer another thing for the experimental method. I did mention it earlier. Sorry? Okay, so we use a tape measure. It's not the same measure, tape measure. We don't know that it's calibrated. We don't know that the method for using tape measure was the same. Maybe certain doctors aren't very good with tape measures. And so... So hopefully, anyway, that you get, we've probably laboured the point and gone on about this for a while, but hopefully you get the idea. Now, we're not going to go through this now. I was going to leave it as a classroom exercise to run through this and do it with weights, but I think time is moving on and no one really wants to use the full 3 hours if they don't have to. So I'm going to skip this and I'll leave it there as something, if you feel so inclined or want to brush up on your understanding or even do this at revision time, I'll leave this as an exercise to be run at a later date. You've got the data and it's really going through that same process again to examine whether there is a difference in weight of the two groups. But I think because this has come up, we will just look briefly at what if the data is not normal. What do we do if the data is not normal? There's various things we can do. So firstly, we looked at the data and it didn't look convincingly normal to start with. But we can run some tests to see whether we can reasonably expect parametric tests to be reliable on these data sets. Now, I will say a word of caution about using these. They're indicative only. They are not a definite yes, definitely no, or a you must use parametric, you must use non-parametric. But they can give you, if you're not sure what to do, you're not confident in a certain analysis, they can help to guide you and they can give you some help. But again, their output is a p-value. So we have to just interpret that p-value in exactly the way that we normally would. So the question these tests are asking is there a difference between the distribution of the data that I have and the normal distribution? So the null hypothesis is that there's no difference, which means if we get a p-value, say, bigger than 0.05, then we're going to accept the null hypothesis and assume that we can run parametric tests on this data. And once again, we can use our old friend SPSS to have a look at this. So I'm going back to the software. Back to the data set. I don't think you technically need to do this, but I like to look at the numbers. And we're going to look at another menu option. So we can go to the Analyze menu. You'll find that we use the Analyze menu a lot because that's where all of the main functionality in the program is. That's where we can crunch the numbers. And again, we're going to look at descriptive statistics. But on this occasion, we're going to use this option that says explore. And it brings up a box that looks like this. So that was, let's show you again, that was under analyze, analyze, descriptive statistics, and explore, which is the third option down. And you should get a box that looks like this. And we have these things, these things that we might want to explore, the dependent list. The dependent is that variable that we're testing, the thing that we're interested in. So in this case, we're interested in height, because that's the thing we're wondering, does height change between the groups? Is height dependent on which group you're in? So I'm going to select height, and then I'm going to press on the arrow that points to the right, move it into the dependent list. Now, do you remember when we pressed on the descriptives button previously, it just gave us descriptive statistics and grouped together heights of both groups. And that wasn't much good to us. What this box allows us to do is put in a factor. So the factor is that split variable. It's that thing that allows us to choose how we split up the heights. And in this case, again, we're going to choose whether they're a clone trooper or a stormtrooper, Republic or Imperial. So there. And you can move that by pressing this button. You can move that into the factor list. Let's have a look in here. There's a statistics box, so you can, it's got descriptives already ticked, so we're going to get some descriptive statistics output. So you get all sorts of interesting information. We look under options. We don't have a clue what that means. So we press on plots, which is going to be more useful. So if you look at the plots option, you'll see this this option here, normality test plots with tests. Highlight that here. Normality plots with tests. And if you check that box, we'll get some normality plots with their tests. And you can choose various plots here as well. Interesting. I wonder what happens if we check histogram. Haven't done this, so. I'm now going to press. If you've got it configured as so, you can press on continue. And then press on. Here you go. You have some more options here. We're going to have both the plots and the statistics because we can, but you can just choose to have the statistics. I'm going to press OK. So hopefully you have a box that looks a bit like this. And then we wait, and it does some hard work and plots these. So let's see what we've got. Well, you'll see there's a whole load of output here. And so you've got the descriptives, firstly, for the clone troopers and the storm troopers. It will mean 95% confidence intervals. Again, we talked about those earlier, and it's calculated them for us. Standard error. These measures here, skewness and kurtosis, are measures of how, skewed or how not normal the data is. But we're not going to use those directly, at least. What we are going to look at is here, the two tests of normality. And if you look at the output, the things to note So we have, in each row, we have the clone trooper and the storm trooper. Remember, we're really interested in this column here. That's our probability output. What's the probability of obtaining this difference from normality by chance? And we're comparing this threshold, this with our threshold value of 95%. That's the default. So this, would anyone like to explain what we see here? As in, looking at those p-values, do we have normal data or not, according to these two tests, at least? Saba has an answer. Anyone else have an answer? Or does everyone else think it's very nearly 12 o'clock and I don't care?
Whether your lab work or your community work data collection, you don't require part of your proposal is to run, how you're going to analyze the data. So either you're going, because you don't know what sort of data you're going to say, it depends on the data distribution. We may run t-test, otherwise if the data is not normal, we should be going through the alternative test. So how you check your data then, when you have your data in life, by the end of July or whatever, second year, you have this test available. We're going to remind you, but you need to understand this concept from the beginning. So did you get it? Do you have any questions? In this case, why we have it over 0.05, that means our data is normally distributed. This test is comparing whether our data is normally distributed or not. So if it is not normally distributed, you will see that the sig is 0.05 or less. That means our data is different from the test of normality. So then we have to go again, then we have to decide to take the alternative test. Okay? So did you get it? Are you functioning? Yeah. Have some too. No. Since they are both of them the same test, one of them or all of them had some what's the expense thing one of the tests, is it?
Shapiro-Wilk. Yeah, I'll refer you to a really excellent research paper that I can't remember. You don't need to worry. The reason this is complicated is only because we haven't covered the material that you use to explain this. But what was done in a paper, I think it was last year, I used it last year, it may have been come out a couple of years prior to that, where someone actually compared the power of different normality tests. So just a brief explanation of power for those of you who don't understand. You know how we did this, we all took different samples and we all got roughly the same result. That would mean that we have a high power. High power just means that we're all getting the same result. So our samples are all big enough so that we all get the same result, even though we're looking at different people. So it means that there's not much variation in the p-values that you get. So the Shapiro-Wilk test in that study came out as basically saying, yeah, the p-values don't vary that much, so they're more concrete than the p-values you get from a Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, the KS test. I'm afraid I'm not very good at remembering how many O's there are. Yep.
Okay, so you're going to look at those two tests, but as well, you shouldn't be let down by this test. If you're sample, for example, you have a thousand and you jump, and you find there is a level of significance, for example, reaching 0.0, for example, 6, which is the data is not that normal. But if you visualize it, run as well as histogram, so you see you have right fusion instead of using that alternative. So it's not just something that a taboo, if you see, for example, not significant, that you shouldn't use it. No. It's still you can use it, but it depends on the sample size as well. And this is agreed.
Thanks, Ella. I have just written it. You may not be able to read my handwriting, but I did just write up the null hypothesis to help us. It's worth keeping this in mind when trying to interpret these tests. So the null hypothesis is no difference between the sample distribution and the normal distribution. So if you think null hypothesis is no difference, what are the two things I'm trying to compare? My sample distribution with a normal distribution. That's what these tests compare. So then you know that if your p-value is greater than 0.05, that's indicative of it being sufficiently normal to warrant using parametric tests. And at least this is a good indicator. And without other information, that this is helpful. But even there, you'll see this variation in the numbers. So for the clone trooper, The significance is 0.2 for the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, and it's about the same, 0.2 for the Shapiro-Wilk. But there's a huge difference there for the stormtrooper category. However, that's really, when we plotted those histograms, we could see that for one of the categories, it wasn't that convincing as normally distributed data. What this test is just showing you that actually, you can see here that the Shapiro-Wilk might be more reliable because it seems to have, say, well, this one looks less normal than that one. But even so, they're still sufficiently normal to warrant using the parametric tests that we used. There you go. So then we are left with that question, why believe one test over another? And all I will say on that matter is it's a very good question. And you will find that lots of people debate it. And generally what happens is people will use their pet tests rather than necessarily the best or most appropriate. It's actually a real pain that we've got to 12 o'clock. So I don't want to take much longer, but there's just one thing that I'd like to do on this, and I'd just like to run a very quick, show you how to run a non-parametric version of what we've just done. So I'm hoping this should be a very straightforward and quick activity. What we've just done seems to support the use of the t-test. The Shapiro-Wilk test and the Smirnov test have both supported our choice of using parametric tests. But let's suppose that they didn't. Or let's suppose that we put in our work for review and all three reviewers, peer reviewers at the journal, all said they would like to see a non-parametric test run on this. And then you're in the situation that, well, you might be confident in what you've done, but someone has asked you to do something different. And we can do that. And it's actually very straightforward. So if we're comparing means, in a parametric regime, we use a t-test. If we are not confident of normality or have other reasons to not use a t-test, we can use the equivalent, which is a Mann-Whitney U test. So the equivalent non-parametric test is the Mann-Whitney U test. All the non-parametric bit means is it doesn't rely on any underlying distribution, such as the normal distribution. However, I would encourage you to read up what the assumptions are that are made, because they can be more stringent in some cases than the requirements for the t-test. But I'll leave that as an additional activities to justify why. And again, you can go to lead statistics, for example, and type in lead statistics, Mann-Whitney U test, SPSS, and it will bring up a page and tell you all about it. But for now, what we're going to just quickly do before I end the session, we're going to go back to our favourite piece of software and get back to our data set. And this time, we're going to run that Mann-Whitney test. And again, it's under Analyze. And you'll see near the bottom, like halfway down, non-parametric tests. And this is quite easy to run. Remember we said we have two independent samples, two independent groups. So we want to run a non-parametric test on independent samples. And if you press on that, you'll get a box that looks like this. See, we've got these tabs at the top that say objective, fields, and settings. Up here. So click on fields. The test fields, that's the thing that we want to test. So we're interested in still in height. Click on height. And in the groups, Republic or Imperial Trooper. And there is none of this fiddling around with what coding we're using. The software sorts all this out for us, and you can just press run. I'm going to continue with this for now. I'm going to finish the session, and then if there's other questions, we can cover those afterwards. I think that's probably the best way to go. So so if you run this, if you scroll down in the output, this is probably why people like non-parametric tests, because you do it in SPSS, and it gives you a box that you can pretty much just copy and paste the text into your thesis or whatever. So here it tells me that this distribution of height in centimetres is the same across categories of Republic or Imperial Stormtrooper. So it told me what my null hypothesis is. It tells me what test it ran. It ran an independent samples Mann-Whitney U test. It tells me the significance level was 0.369, and then it tells me the decision it made, and it's going to retain the null hypothesis. That's brilliant. To think this lecture could have been so much quicker if we'd just done that at the beginning rather than the end. But I think it's important to run through the laborious processes that we've been through. And on that note, I shall end the session, and I hope you have an enjoyable rest of the week, and I hope to see you next week for more exciting Star Wars-themed statistics.